don't. I praise cause I know you're still in control. My praise is a weapon, it's more than a sound. My praise is the rock that brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord of my soul. Praise cause you're sovereign, praise cause you reign, praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I praise cause you're faithful, praise cause you're true, praise cause there's nobody greater than you. I praise cause you're sovereign, praise cause you reign, praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I praise cause you're faithful, praise cause you're true, praise cause there's nobody greater than you. Up his sleeves, he ain't just putting on the Ritz. Our God is an awesome God. There is thunder in his footsteps and lightning in his fist. Our God is an awesome God. The Lord wasn't joking when he kicked him out of Eden. Wasn't for no reason that he shed his blood. His return is very close, and so you better be believing. Is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. When the stars starless in the void of the night, our God is an awesome God. Into the darkness and created the light. Our God is an awesome God. Judgment and wrath he poured out on Sodom. Mercy and grace he gave us at the cross. Hope that we're not too quickly forgotten that our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom power. Love our God is an awesome God. 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 He raised from heaven above with wisdom power. Love our God is an awesome God. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working.
Even when I don't feel that you're working, you never stop, you never stop working.
I know it's not mine. So come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your soul, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your soul, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your soul, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Ooh. Ooh. So I throw up my hands and praise you. So I throw up my hand and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing. I believe that you're my healer. I believe that you are all I need. And I believe that you're my portion. And I believe you're more than I believe that you are.
children and the children and the children. May his favor be upon you in a thousand generations, in your family, in your children, in the children, in the children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 he is for you.
Over us this evening. Let's give the Lord a hand. Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for your presence. Lord, I thank you for Sister Maria and this praise team leading us into worship this week. But Father God, most of all, I thank you for your presence. I thank you for your love for each and every one of us. God, I thank you that you have something for us even tonight. And God, I pray that we would just open our hearts and our minds to receive. And Father God, I just pray that you'd just perform miracles here tonight. And Father God, we're going to give you praise for your love, for your glory, for who you are, and for this opportunity, Lord, to serve you tonight. This opportunity to just be able to speak your word. God, we declare that it does not come back void. Lord, I pray that each one that have attended here this week, God, that they have received something that would encourage them in their walk with you. And God, I just pray that your light would so shine in our lives that a lost and dying world would see you. Father, we're going to give you praise, for it's in your holy name we have prayed. Amen. Amen. I believe everyone here tonight has a desire to grow in the Lord, a desire for your life to be used for His honor and His glory. And that is a very humbling desire to have. It's the proper desire to have. But it seems like sometimes we seek this, and sometimes it seems hard to find that. So in order to grow in the things of God and to be used in a powerful way, we've got to lay down our will. We have to lay down our will. The theme this week, when Sister Gina asked me to speak, and I thought, well, this is the first. I've never spoken at a ladies' conference before, but that's okay, because God's word goes out to everyone. And as we seek to lay down our will, in order for God's will, if you want to say God's life, His will, to be expressed through us, then we have to give Him our will, i.e. our lives. So I'm going to look at the scripture this evening as we come together tonight to lay down our wills. I'm going to find this in actually the book of Genesis, but before I go there, I've made a declaration when we first started this thing that everyone here tonight has the God-free given gift of choice. We all make choices every day that are not manipulated by God. In other words, He loves us enough to give us free will. He gives us the power, and I say this all the time, that a choice is the most powerful thing in the world. Things that we choose is very powerful. And so I make a declaration tonight that we have to, if we're going to live a life for God, we have to choose His will. And I'm going to give you some characters in the Bible that chose the will of God. If we want to look in Genesis chapter 21, starting in or 22, starting in verse 1. Now it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham, and he said, here I am. Then he said, take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled up his donkey, took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son, and he split the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. The lad and I will go yonder and worship. And we, I love this part of that scripture. And we will come back to you. Abraham had to lay his will down. And he had to be obedient to God's will. I believe that there was so much faith in Abraham trusting God's will that he was willing to sacrifice his son. But I believe that if he actually sacrificed his son, he believed that God would raise him from the dead, because he made a declaration that we will come back to you. There was a confidence in the will of God inside of Abraham. Laying down your will actually lays a platform for the miracles of God. We all desire to see God move in miracles in our lives and in our families and our homes. And sometimes we wear ourselves out praying, oh God, why, when we've not given Him a platform to operate on. You see, the Bible tells us that obedience is better than what? Sacrifice. God wants our obedience. God wants us to be willing to operate in His will and not our own. So what Abraham did is he laid a platform for God to show His glory, amen? And did God show out that day? Yes, He did. And God is the same yesterday, today, and evermore. God will honor those who serve him. That is his promise, and his promises are always yes and amen. In the book John chapter 12 and verse 26, if anyone serves me, let him follow me, and where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, him my Father will honor. Listen, I believe every one of us here tonight wants to be honored by God. We want to bring honor to him, but folks, let me tell you what, he will bring honor to you. And that's a very, very humbling thing. You see, we said this earlier in the conference. We don't need more of God. He needs more of us. God is God. God operates. God moves in power. We're not placing our faith and our confidence in that because God has a desire to move in our lives. God has a desire. We're not lacking anything. If you're here tonight, you're not lacking anything if you're a child of God. If we feel that we're lacking something, we're being deceived. The enemy is a liar. He's roaring around like a he's moving around like a roaring lion, seeking people who he may devour. So what are we withholding from God? You see, we've got to give God all that we have. We've heard testimonies after testimony this week of how people wanted to live and want to live for themselves, seeking something within themselves, seeking something, but it wasn't until they were willing to say, no longer I, but Christ that lives within me. When we come to the end of ourselves and realize that this flesh is non-redeemable, my soul is a completed work. My mind is in process, but this is non-redeemable. Glory to God. God's going to give me a glorified body one day. Amen. God is going to move and do things that's beyond my understanding. But I've got to trust him, and I've got to quit living for this right here. Because it'll find pleasure in a moment, then brings destruction. When we live for the flesh, you know what? You can find happiness for a moment, but then it takes more and more and more and more and more. And it doesn't last. And our lives will start spiraling down. And there's an empty void in our lives. We want something to be there that we can't find. So we've got to die to this self-interest if we want to do the will of God. In the book of John, chapter 12, verses 24 and 25. Most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces what? Much grain. He who lives his life will do what? Lose it. And he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Wow. Wow. You see, a seed falls into the ground and it dies. If it didn't, we would never see the fruit of the seed. If we plant our life like a seed, then God's life will be expressed through us. When we die to the flesh, we take on the will and the nature of Jesus. Of Jesus himself. God's life is God's will. Be ye transformed into the image of Christ. There needs to be a transformation that takes place. You see, when we persist on pursuing our will over God's will for our life, we demonstrate selfishness. Selfishness. Or our will for our life must die so God's will can live. Again, it's a selfish thing. You see, sometimes when we live our life our own way, it limits God. Sometimes we want God in the hour of need. We want God when everything is bad. We want God when we're hurting and struggling and we need something.
But what about when things are good? What about when things are going okay? Folks, we got to come to a place that we need God every moment of every day of our lives. We've got to come to a place that we can experience Him in the joys of the world in our life. You see, we've let religion come and destroy our concept of what a relationship with God is. It's not a bunch of do's and don'ts. It's a love relationship between us and God. It's a love relationship that brings confidence. It's a love relationship that builds faith. It's a love relationship that releases His supernatural work in us and through us. Because, folks, let me tell you what, He's still a miracle-working God. He still will save these family members that we love and we pray for every day. He still restores marriages. He still restores homes. He still does a lot of things, glory to God. He is still sitting on the throne, and He's still the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. But He's got to be the Lord of our lives. You see, it's hard sometimes, because what happens is the enemy brings so much destruction to our lives, and if we're not careful, we let that become our identity. And our identity is all the negative stuff that's happened to us, in us, through us, and everything else. When folks, let me tell you what, when we get saved, we become a new creation. Behold, all things have passed away. All things have become new. You see, we got to quit resurrecting the dead man on the opposite side of salvation. How many of you ever heard, well, that's just the way that I was raised? Well, I was raised this way. Glory to God, that's the biggest cop-out I've ever heard in my life. You know what you're saying when you say that? I just resurrected the dead man. You're saying the power of Jesus in my life is not as strong as the flesh raising. The raising that I had in the flesh is not as strong or powerful as the spirit man that lives within me. I'm telling you, when the spirit man rises up, and it's not our will but His will, let me tell you what, He will manifest in our lives, and our actions and our words and the things of our life will produce His light and His glory. It will release things in us and through us that we so desire for anyway. You see, when we pursue God, we become more like Jesus. Let's look at Jesus' attitude in the book of Mark, chapter 14, starting in verse 32. Then they came to a place which was named Gethsemane. And He said to His disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And He took Peter, James, and John with Him, and He began to be troubled and deeply distressed. Then He said to them, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch." He went a little further and fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from Him. And He said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for You. Take this cup away from Me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what You will. Nevertheless, not my will, but Thy will be done." You see, when we get transformed in the image of Christ, it's no longer our will. That we have a desire. That doesn't mean we have to be happy about it sometimes. Jesus was in such agony that He sweat drops of blood. He was in such agony. He even asked, "Father, let this cup pass from Me." But if you'll read the whole story, you're going to find out when He said, "Not my will, but Thy will be done," the Father sent ministering angels to come and lift Him up. Folks, let me tell you what, God wants to move in our lives supernaturally. He wants to minister to us and give us help that we don't even know that's there. He said that He would be our rear guard. He said that He would watch over us. "I will be with you even to the ends of the earth." How many times do we feel all alone? How many times do we feel all alone in the struggle? Well, I'm here to tell you, we're not alone. You're being deceived. You've got a Father that loves you, and you've got a Father that's about you, and you have a Father that will send His warring angels to minister to you when we're operating in obedience to His will. When we're operating in obedience to His will. So we've got to do this. We've got to lay down our will to serve Him. If I were to ask you tonight, how many here tonight has a desire to be blessed? I believe that we came because we love the Lord. We came because we wanted to hear a word from Him. We came because we wanted to be blessed. Well, I'm telling you, you've got a God here tonight that wants to bless you, that has a desire to bless your life. But we've got to die to the flesh and embrace the cross of Jesus. We must be about the Father's business. We're in a world today that's not about the Father's business. We're in a world today that is about the flesh. And look around you and see the destruction that it has brought. Look at the confusion that's in the world today. Look at the hatred that's in the world today. Look at the things the Word of God said in the last days that they will say good is evil and evil is good. Folks, we're seeing that manifest around us right now. They're saying mothers and daughters and fathers and sons will be against each other. We're seeing that in the world right now. And we can look about us, and if we're not careful, we look at the world and it can bring you down. But do you remember when Peter got out of the boat? He had his eyes on Jesus. Glory to God. He defied all laws of nature. He was walking in human flesh and defied the laws of nature as long as he had his eyes on Jesus. But folks, we're doing the same thing today. We're taking our eyes off Jesus and we're looking at the boisterous waves of this world. And that's not His will for our lives. The only way that He can carry us is for us to keep our eyes on Him. And as we keep our eyes on Him, glory to God, I love this. When Peter went down, he made a confession, Jesus saved me. The Word of God used the adjective there, immediately. Immediately, Jesus reached and picked him up. Folks, God wants to work in our lives immediately. He does. He works immediately. Well, I've been praying over a situation and praying over a situation and praying. You know what? Sometimes it may not be the situation that needs to change. It may be our prerogative. The way that we think about the situation. We may need spiritual eyes opened up that we can see that God truly loves us. He may possibly be allowing a situation in our lives to grow us. The Bible says that if we will give everything to Him, what the enemy has meant for evil, God will what? Use it for good. Glory. We have a choice tonight. We can give Him something tonight. We can give Him our will and offer Him a platform to bless, to show His glory. You see, when we got saved, God positioned us in heavenly places. Do you realize the Scripture says that He already sees you sitting in the heavenly places? He's not restricted by our time. He sees the past. He sees the future. God has already positioned us for blessing. God has already positioned us. You see, we've got to be, this evening, we've got to be like that seed that is dead, but once placed in good soil, the hand of God is the one that brings forth the great harvest. Sometimes we're working for the harvest. Sometimes we're trying to help Him out, amen? Sometimes we're trying to do His work, and it will wear you out. And we run around tired, and we run around tired spiritually when God says, I want to give you rest. I want to give you rest. Lay your life down. Give me a platform to work. Give me a platform to show my glory. We've got to run to God, not away from God. We must pursue the will of God at all cost. Because, folks, we cannot do it on our own. Isn't it funny how when we do something wrong, we run from God? Folks, I believe if we knew the love of God, we'd run to Him every day of our lives. If we knew that God is truly standing with arms wide open, that He's not a God of condemnation. Therefore, there is no condemnation for those who are what? In Christ Jesus. I get tired of seeing God's children not living the life that Christ died for. And that's including myself. We've got to come to a place that we understand that we cannot do it. You know what we can do? We can choose. We can make a choice to lay our will down. I ask tonight, and I'm not going to be long, but I ask tonight, are we dead to the flesh? The way that we live our lives, are we dead to the flesh? Is God using us to fulfill the full potential of our lives that He intended? I don't know, and I'm not here to judge. But I am here to say that He longs to, that He has a desire. He has a desire to use us. To use us not only to bring peace and joy and the fruits of His Spirit in our own lives, but for the lives of our families. So what are we holding on to? I'm going to ask Sister if she'll come to the piano just for a moment. What are we holding on to? Are we holding on to hurts? Are we holding on to bitterness? Are we holding on to unforgiveness? Are we holding on to resentment? Are we holding on to false expectations and dreams? Are we holding on to bitterness towards someone else? Or are we holding on to even bitterness toward God? Because He's not moved in the way that we thought He should, or He's not answered a prayer the way that we thought He should. You see, all these things are selfish things. Are we willing to put our trust in Him and say, you know what, God, I believe that You know best. I believe that we have a power of a choice, and sometimes when we make a wrong choice, we will suffer consequences. You see, He is a just and a fair God, and He must punish sin. But if there is correction from the Father, it's because He loves us, and His correction does not condemn us. It encourages us to come to His love. To come to that place that we're experiencing Jesus, that we're experiencing God's will for our lives, and we're seeing God move, and we're seeing the fruits of the Spirit manifest in us and in our hearts and our churches and in our families. Who are we living for? Are we living for the flesh? Are we living for our will? Or have we come to a place, Father God, I lay my will down tonight. Not my will, but Thy will be done. As we bow our heads here for just a moment. God's given us an opportunity tonight. To get very right with Him. Put our lives in a position to receive His glory. This is not a place that anyone would judge one another. this is a time that we can come and kneel and get on our face before a mighty God and make that declaration, Father, not my will, but your will be done. Are you willing to lay it down? Because if you do, I promise you, you're going to pick up something wonderful. In the name of Jesus, this altar's open as she sings.